The following is a presentation of TFNN. The Power Trading Hour with your host, David White. Call now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-445-1044. Now, David White.
And welcome all to another excellent edition of the Power Trading Hour with me, your humble, lovable, and squeezably soft host, who has to get more comfortable in his chair and likes to come to you at this time.
The following takes place between 2 p.m. and 3 p.m.
So what do we have going on today? Well, guess what? I had to reboot my machine just before the show, so that is just coming up. Down 5 on the S&P cash, if that is correct. Let's update that just to make sure. Down 4. Dow's down 167, NASDAQ's up 50. Of course, options expiration is tomorrow. It's not one of the quad witching ones, so generally a fairly good indication of the option predictions where it should go is generally fairly good, and it's the bias is a little higher. As I said earlier in the week, I mean, it was showing over 3,000 on the S&P cash, and I didn't. 3,000. I really wasn't buying that, mostly because it was rather thin, i.e. there wasn't that much money out there. A lot of times you get a really nice V pattern, and if it goes a little left or a little to the right, you know, you may be talking $2-3 billion. A little left, a little to the right, maybe $200 million tomorrow. Chicken feed in the scheme of things. So not a lot of reason to push the market around that much. You'd spend more money pushing it than you would getting it. So are they probably sanguine with maybe it drift up into options expiration tomorrow night? I think so, but you know, 2,825-ish on the S&P cash is not beyond the scope of reason as we go into the weekend. And of course, this options expiration cycle is one day short. So a lot of times you get a lot of things kind of crammed in. It's much harder for them to get everything done on Thursday, which they tend to do if they can, and leave Friday as kind of a dead day where not much happens. But we did have a little bit of movement. We got a lot of shorts in the market, and they're going to be really wrong or really right. But my guess is they're probably only going to be a little right and probably a lot wrong, at least at a minimum until next week. We got Tim Ord coming on in the next segment. He's been sending me some charts, so we'll get those up. And we're back and on the air after a few technical issues. And hopefully we got everything up and running. And we've got Tim Ord on the line. How you doing today, Tim?
Good. Thanks for having me on again.
Well, sorry about the delay here. But and when you're dealing with computers, you never know.
Yeah, so that's true.
Are looking at your first chart here today, is if that's the one you want to look at.
Yeah, actually, it's just it's a little bit messy. Probably should have slowed it. I have a five-day average on both of these. But, you know, this is what the market's kind of saying. Look, on the second window down, it's the NYSE down volume compared to total volume. I mean, I took the five-day average of that. And I got some red lines there. So, anyhow, when down volume is going up compared to total volume, that's usually a bearish sign. And back in, looks like mid-January, I got a red line there. And the market hasn't, the down volume started to go up before the market actually peaked.
Okay, which chart are we looking at? Because I don't have any red lines. I've got two charts. One that has NYDV, DNV on the top.
Right. Yeah, that's right. Okay, you should have. Let me see what I sent you here.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure I wasn't the one that was insane here. So.
Yeah, you should have. There's a red line there. A red line around.
The vertical line, you mean?
Yeah, vertical line. Red vertical line.
Yep. Okay, now I got you. I'm still still recovering.
There's one like in mid-January.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. What I'm pointing out there, the down volume was going up before the market actually peaked, and the decline looks very small there. But at the time, it was a normal market, and the decline was probably 2-3% or something. It wasn't huge. Then we had the down volume again in right before mid-February, started going up again. And it kept going up, and even though it was early for like a couple of weeks, the down volume was going up before the market actually turned down, and finally did turn down, and really turned down hard, and it got pretty volatile all the way in March because you had some huge down days, and also you had some huge up days, but finally you went into a low, and down volume started to go down, and da-da-da. Well, the point I'm trying to make here is now, if you go into the current time frame, we got down volume going up again. And so that's just kind of a warning sign that the market, and we're also at a 50% retracement from the February high to the March low, and you got down volume going up. And the bottom chart is actually the up volume compared to total volume. So you got down volume going up, and you got up volume going down. And so the market's kind of hesitating here. Will it turn to a top? Well, there's some bearish signs. The market momentum-wise hasn't turned down yet, but the market is showing us some bearish signs, what I'm trying to say, over the last 4 or 5 days here. You don't want
down
volume going up when it's going, market's going sideways. So go ahead.
In what time frame do you think bearish? Short term, you mean, or medium term?
Yeah, just short term. Yeah,
okay.
But it could last a while. You know, maybe, you know, previous times when this stuff kind of turns up and down, it could be a week or two. Yeah, and I'm thinking, a week or two. You know, not long term.
The
but
market.
I don't know how big the pullback could be. It could be a decent pullback. Don't know.
The market seems to have a lot of times look for May or around May to start selling off. Is it something you think could last another week or two?
The sideways pattern, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, I went back and looked compared to 2008, you know, because basically the VIX hit 80 only once before, twice. The current time frame, you know, back in March. And the last time it hit 80 was back in 2008 at that market. And it wasn't quite the low back in 2008. It's still stumbled a little bit lower. But my point is, since both times the VIX hit 80, McCall and Oscar went from minus 400 back in 2008 to plus 400 in 2008. Well, the same thing happened here. McCall and Oscar did hit minus 400 at the March lows, and we hit right at 400 at the March, over last several days. It wasn't too long ago. So McCall and Oscar did the exact same thing. Back in 2008, when the McCall and Oscar did hit plus 400, when it turned down, the market had another a crash. I don't know, crash is not the right word, had another actually a pretty scary decline. And so McCall and Oscar is actually matching what it did back in 2008 like it is doing it right now. Will this pullback be a sort of a big decline? Don't know. But
Are you talking about the May 5th, 2008, when I think just about every financial or broker dealer retested a previous high on about half the volume. Does that sound about the date you're thinking about, May 5th?
I don't have that chart right in front of me. I mean, I could look it up, but I'm thinking there's a lot of similarities between now and 2008. So I'm thinking we're kind of leading to that scenario. And even though the VIX hit 80, that wasn't the final low. The VIX did not make a lower low or actually a higher high, but the price of the S&Ps did make a lower low. So I'm thinking this is what could happen around this time around, too, that the VIX won't make another higher above 80, but the price low will break below the March 23rd low at some point.
The only thing
we're
not
too far away from it.
The only thing I'd have to probably point out on the VIX is that they changed it, and it went from a 19 and 38 day moving average for the 5 and 10% down to 24 and 36. So it doesn't act the way it does. In fact, I think everything from 2012 or 2013 acts very differently than 2008 because of that. They shortened it up because I think they were losing too much money, because if you got on the right side of the VIX, it was going to go through the roof. And a lot of people got blown out back in 2008. They finally fixed it, I think, 2012. But it's not the same VIX that it was, although I don't know if it's going to operate that much differently over time. But the levels are probably going to be kind of different. We're going to ask you to hang through the break, Tim. We'll be back in just a minute. And, we'll talk about this a little bit more.
If you are in the CD market and looking for a secure investment, the Tiger First Mortgage Program may work for you. The security for these first mortgages are building lots in the Tax Opportunity Zone in St. Petersburg, Florida. The Tax Act of 2018 set up tax-free zones across the country where you can build and hold for 10 years and pay no tax on the profits, which makes these lots valuable. The investment is anywhere from $30,000 to $75,000. The interest paid is 7% yearly, paid on a monthly basis. According to Bankrate.com, the best rate for a four-year CD in the country as of February 20th is 3.1%. A $50,000 investment at a normal four-year CD rate of 3.1% would give you income of $1,550 per year or $6,200 over the four-year period. That same $50,000 investment in a Tiger First Mortgage Program would give you $3,500 per year or $14,000 over the 4 years. Which would you prefer, $6,200 or $14,000 of interest on your investment? If you would like more information about the Tiger First Mortgage Program, you can call me at 877-518-9190. That's 877-518-9190.
If you haven't checked out the newsletters page of TFNN.com, what are you waiting for? All of the TFNN newsletters are informative, up-to-date, affordable, and a must-have for every trader looking to gain a competitive informational edge in today's markets. TFNN newsletters cover every aspect of the markets to offer you the very latest in market news. Plus, new subscribers get to test drive our newsletters risk-free for 30 days. From all aspects of the markets, including stocks, bonds, metals, commodities, and tech, there's a newsletter to fit your needs exclusively from TFNN. Stay informed each day you trade and get that competitive edge that will help you stay ahead of the game. Visit our newsletters page by going to TFNN.com and click the newsletters button near the top of the page. TFNN.com, educating investors.
Are China A-shares hot or not? If you trade China A-shares, now may be time to take a closer look. Trade CHAU or CHAD, Direction's daily CSI 300 China A-share bull and bear ETFs. China A-shares in either direction. Visit directioninvestments.com today. An investor should consider the investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of the direction shares carefully before investing. The prospectus and summary prospectus contain this and other information about direction shares. To obtain a prospectus or summary prospectus, please contact direction shares at 866-476-7523. The prospectus or summary prospectus should be read carefully before investing. An investment in the funds is subject to risk, including the possible loss of principal. The funds are designed to be utilized only by sophisticated investors such as traders and active investors. Distributor Foreside Fund Services, LLC.
Don't forget, you can listen to TFNN live on your mobile device 24 hours per day. Go to TFNN.com, then hit Watch Tiger TV. That's TFNN.com, then hit Watch Tiger TV for the latest market information.
We're on the line with Timothy Ord, although everybody calls him Tim. He's the author of The Secret Science of Price and Volume, which I'm holding up now. And, of course, he has his own newsletter that he's had for more than 30 years. You can check him out at ord-oracle.com. Are we finished with this first chart, or is there some more you want to talk
about? Well, actually, I wanted to, you know, we were talking about the VIX, just to clarify. I took the current VIX and went back to 2008. So I didn't. So I'm using the current configurations of the VIX.
And, right, but they,
both
none
times
of those
hit 80s. So that's my point about that. It's, I didn't use the old VIX, VXO, wherever it was. I used the current VIX. So,
right.
But yeah, that's all I wanted to say about that. Not a big deal.
Okay.
But yeah,
so we've got a second chart here.
All right, second chart is it's kind of
a
bottom chart, and it's SPY VIX, and I did a 3-day average with it. And sometimes you get whipped around in this, but it kind of keeps you in the trend. When it's going up, basically the trend's up. In other words, when it's going up, SPY is outperforming the VIX. When it's going down, the VIX is outperforming the SPY. And I took a 3-day average of it. And when it turns down, that's usually kind of a worrisome sign. In other words, the VIX is starting to outperform the SPYs, and that's, can be a bearish sign. And if you notice at the bottom chart there, it flips sideways. So it's not going up, it's not going down either, but that's kind of another warning sign. I guess if it turned down and along with the up-down volume or the up or the down volume compared to total volume going up, that would add to the bearish scenario. So this one hasn't really confirmed that the market has turned down, but it has at least gone sideways here. So I'd have to say on a very short-term basis, the trend is at best neutral, but it's leaning more bearish than positive. So the market, could we just be stalling in here for consolidation phase before heading higher? That's a possibility. Or if the down volume keeps increasing, then I'm thinking we're making a short-term top. And I'm thinking I'm in that camp right now. I'm thinking we're probably in the process of at least making a short-term top in this vicinity.
Last time we had you on, I think we talked about the fear and greed index, or maybe it was a couple of times ago, the CNN business poll.
Yeah.
During this period that we've gone through, has that given you any signals?
I think it's around 41%. I haven't checked it today, but I think I checked it yesterday.
42 today.
Is what?
42 today.
That was 42. So it's, it's about half and half. I don't know. It's not really bullish or bearish. It's kind of neutral. Can you get tops with that? Yeah. Can you have the market continue higher? Yeah. So it's not, as far as the CNN fear greed ratio or indicator, not really giving a signal either bullish or bearish. It's more or less neutral. So I think anything could happen here. I think the physics, of the market, in other words, will down volume win the turn here, or will this down volume decrease and up volume start coming in again and where we can push higher. The way I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, you know, we had a gap here, you know, a couple of weeks ago down to what looks like about 255, 250 area on the SPYs. Maybe we just go down and fill that. I don't know. But I'm thinking we're due for something other than up here is what it's starting to look like.
So when you say that, most people don't, I guess if they haven't heard you a lot, you basically say that a market will go up and it will do something else. And that else means go sideways or down.
Right. Yeah. I'm thinking, yeah, I think the ups is done for now. You know, can we consolidate here for a week or two? If we do that and the market, you know, fails to go down in that time frame, that would be very bullish because that would be quite a bit of a cause for the next rally up. You know, there's more, in my opinion, there's nothing more bullish than a sideways market for a couple of weeks building cause for the next move. And so if we did that and we really didn't go down, then we could see some really strength to the upside. So, but personally, I'm not in that camp. I'm thinking we're still in, like, I'm thinking there's a lot of similarities between now and 2008. Personally, I think at least we're going to touch that March 23rd low at some point, and have some more fear in the market. That's how I'm looking at it. It's very, you know, these spike bottoms are pretty rare. True, we had one back in the 2018, December 24th, where the market went straight down and turned around and went straight back up. I don't think we're in one of those time frames. I'm thinking market's going to go up and at least go back down and test the lows at some point.
We've got about 2 minutes left, maybe a little less. What are your thoughts on gold and the way it's moved here during all this period?
Well, I look at the bullish percent index for the gold miners index is up like 92%. In other words, 92% of the stocks there in gold miners index are on buy signals. That's pretty darn strong. However, we're up against GDX is up against the previous highs up around 31. And I think we could probably stall here and possibly there's a gap around 26, 25, 26. That we're around 30, 30 and a half right now in GDX. I think we could possibly fill that gap. But it's just a minor decline before the market heads higher again. I think we're entering into an inflationary time frame. Gold stocks have really been, hadn't done a whole lot or hadn't done much at all over the last couple of years since we had decent rally in 2016, but after that rally in 2016, the market virtually went sideways other than this decline we had in March where everybody sold everything. And I think we're probably breaking out to the upside. There's a 16-year cycle low we're in that's bullish, an 8-year cycle low. I think we're heading much higher. And actually, if you ever did a silver-gold ratio or do it the other way around, gold-silver ratio, where historically that ratio is extremely low, suggesting, you know, silver is extremely cheap compared to gold. So I'm actually bullish on gold, but I'm more bullish on silver just because it's compared to gold, it's so darn cheap. So I'm thinking, I think the gold market and gold miners will outperform the SPX from this point on. And I don't know if we had this last time we talked.
Well, we're going to go to the break anyway, Tim. So that'll be, we're kind of running out of time. But anyway, I want to thank you for being on. We have you back in 2 weeks. We'll think a little bit more about this or get a little bit more of your opinions then. You can find Tim at ordit-oracle.com. Of course, you can find his book, The Secret Science of Price and Volume, on Amazon. Thanks for being on, Tim. We'll see you in 2 weeks.
Yep.
I'm certain you are or strive to be one of the best of the best at everything you do in life. It's the most common trait that we tigers and tigresses share. If you're looking to become the best of the best when it comes to managing your money, let me teach you to do what most wealth managers tell you can't be done, which is how to time the markets. I'm Steve Rhodes, author of Mastering Probability, and for the last 12 months, Timer Digest has been tracking my newsletter signals, which have earned me the ranking as their number one market timer in the nation for the S&P 500 for the last 12, 6, and 3 months. Timer Digest also ranks me as the number one market timer for gold as well. The fact is, markets can be timed, and I'll teach you the exact set of tools that I use that has transformed me into one of the best at what I do. Sign up for Mastering Probability today by clicking on the newsletter tab on the homepage of TFNN.com and get immediate access to workshops where I take you step by step how to use an extraordinary set of tools as well as provide great market calls too. Sign up today.
David White's newsletter, The Technology Insider, is focused like a laser on finding the next big things in technology. If you had invested only $10,000 in Microsoft in 1986, you'd have been a millionaire by 2000. Disruptive technology like Microsoft's is the key to these massive long-term profits, and The Tech Insider is the vehicle from TFNN to capitalize on these opportunities. This is the go-to newsletter that identifies, monitors, and profits on mostly little-known cutting-edge companies with great long-term prospects. David's experience is as an inventor of Emmy-winning animation products for TV and Hollywood that propelled a company public. Match that with 14 years as a full-time trader, and he's uniquely qualified to guide you through the light-speed world of ever-evolving high-tech. If you're ready to ride the next big technology bull market for less than $40 per month, log on to TFNN.com and get your two-week free trial to the Technology Insider. Get in on the ground floor of the next big thing today. With markets trading with extreme volatility and peaks and troughs everywhere, regardless of what you're looking at in the markets, this is a great time to see the type of analysis Basil Chapman delivers for his subscribers every market day with the Opening Call newsletter. Basil has been analyzing markets, providing his take for subscribers to his trading services since 1984. Every morning, Basil publishes an update for his subscribers, along with weekend and evening updates when warranted. The Opening Call provides traders a daily market overview with regard to the direction of the key indices, selective stocks, and commodities, along with specific recommendations, including stops and targets. You also gain instant access to Basil's subscriber webinar archive from earlier this year, a dark cloud cover, and essential market analysis. Ride the Chapman wave today by signing up for the Opening Call newsletter on the front page of TFNN.com under the newsletter tab. New subscribers get a 30-day money-back guarantee, so you have nothing to risk. Sign up today.
Catch Tom O'Brien, professional trader and educator, founder of TFNN, also a special guest on CNBC. Tom will bisect and dissect the markets. The Tom O'Brien Show, next on TFNN.
And we're back. Just looking at the GDX, and the one thing I thought that meant that we could have kind of a little bit of a pullback in the gold miners is the recent test of the previous high in the GDX on much lighter volume. February 24th, 3184, that's 87 million shares, got tested by 59 million shares 2 days ago. You're pushing up today a little bit higher than yesterday on 24. I don't think it's the end of the world. But wouldn't be surprised to see that gap at about 27 tested. And again, if gold isn't anything, it's one that challenges your belief in everything all the time. But we shall see. As we've been saying, or Tim Ord was talking about the possibility of the market going a little sideways, kind of what I've been kind of dancing around, and that is that we've had lower volume pullbacks, and the big days upward have been fairly good. I know somebody earlier in the den was talking about Amazon. Another thing that you have at really big highs that we haven't had is shorts quit shorting. Amazon, of course, a big day today, but yesterday during the day, what did you see? Well, what was it, 30%? Something, 28% of the shares that were traded yesterday were traded as short positions. Today, I won't know until about, I think about 6:30 or 7:30 tonight, what that volume was for short positions. But generally, you don't see a lot of heavy shorting when you're really going to get a significant high. It can be temporary. But generally what you'll do is go up like you did today on it, pull back a little bit, go back up. You got no volume the next time, and that's where it fails. We'll talk more about this tomorrow, and we'll get our technical difficulties ironed out. So when you can, not when you have to, and we will see you here tomorrow. Same bat channel, same bat time.